Good evening, everyone. In case we are live, maybe we are. Of course, the live dashboard hangs. Zero drop frames, so far in stream. Yeah, I guess should be live. Amazing technology in 2019. didn't even really pay attention to this Microsoft event because life and work and other stuff are also on there, Microsoft. But as the news are full with this, we could watch the video, but the last time we did this, our secondary More Life channel got copyright struck by Apple, so probably not watching this live stream here, although whatever. Anyway, so summary here from other sites and some notes. So of course, most of the stuff I can't recommend, not because Microsoft, but because not the most amazing. So what did they announce? In a very short brief overview, some Surface Laptop 3, Surface Pro 7, Surface Pro X, Surface Neo, Duo and Buds. Most of the stuff, of course, not the most interesting for us. For example, not that we need to mention it later again, some Surface Buds for some headset stuff that don't even look the most amazing in my opinion here. They look a little bit Mattel cheapish, but whatever. Anyway, I would not buy such either. Is it 249 maybe? Omnisound, is it Omnisound? One click pairing with desktop. I would in general not recommend such proprietary something. Don't even look the most amazing, so probably don't need to spend more time on that. Also, this Duo, so they are back with phones, Neo and Duo, I think. The Duo here being some dual screen thing, which yeah, I'm not really sure. Although I think they run Android, right? So even Microsoft, well, they gave up already on their Windows phone and tablet stuff. But now, of course, additionally, just checking my audio. Dual screen stuff running with Android, of course, most likely more reliable than the Galaxy Fold, but of course not as cool technology. And of course, some millimeter of a gap there. Not really sure why I would want or need this. Maybe secure shell session, but even then maybe the folding bezel there is annoying. So, and yeah, whatever. What is the Neo anyway? So let's talk about the more important things. What is here? Surface Neo is, what is it, first Neo, where is it even? So Surface Duo dual screen. What is the Neo One Pencil? No more product whatsoever, whatever the Neo is. Anyway, I wanted to talk more about his Windows 10X running on Neo, or supports of Windows apps. Well, I don't quite get it right here on this summary. Anyway, I would open here Microsoft product listings, but they don't have them yet, at least as far as I can see. So what is more newsworthy here of all the stuff that nobody wants anyway, is actually the laptop. So you have seen in my previous videos, I have a Surface Pro 2 and Surface Pro 3, and I would not buy them again, not only for repairability, you need to have hot air off the display, and they have touch diseases starting from the Microsoft Surface Pro 3. Entric digitizer there, and whatever there is with whatever is coming there apart, so can't recommend this as per previous videos. Also, let's by the way check if this even is going public anyway. So most newsworthy here is actually that they have a pretty fine AMD laptop, and that actually somewhat makes me think whether I should, but anyway, so they have here one of the highest, where would that even be? Yeah, yada yada, here, probably. So that might be the best, actually, as sad as it is. You have seen all the ThinkPad and other stuff here. Usually there was some small detail with something, usually around thermal limiting, or otherwise like Lenovo not having the highest resolution displays for the AMD Ryzen laptop. That is of course really sad. So this I would expect. I've not, so this is relatively raw here, not really found product pages or whatsoever yet, but I would expect this is a 3x2 screen, so that might be totally amazing for programmers and IT specialized like us. 15 inch, so relatively large with small bezels, AMD, and I'm actually not really so sure. They write here on another news article which is this one, which is slightly misleading in regards to AMD stuff. They write here actually that closely with AMD, apparently in one building, for the best, most amazing integration, closely with AMD to add additional graphic cores on the 12 nanometer Ryzen 5 and Ryzen 7 surface parts. So maybe they have right new special Microsoft SKUs of the Ryzen. I don't quite. That also could mean, however, huge warning as usual. Everything the companies, either Lenovo with displays or Microsoft certainly with all the other not amazing stuff. And if this is custom silicon, although just adding graphic cores shouldn't be a big deal, that might probably should be relatively easy to probably get going, but you never know what other restrictions Microsoft has done there. And so this is Zen Plus, so still not Zen 2, just like the other regular Ryzen 5 and 7 parts. And optimize the chip to fit inside the slim and light chassis. So apparently maybe another BGA version or whatsoever. And slim and light of the Surface Laptop 3. Also, I've not yet seen repairability. However, at least they have done away with the stupid fabric keyboard that was totally unrepairable. I would hope they finally went back to screws that I recommended there. Repairability video down below. And what I really find strange here, several years ago they met with and so on, shared vision, something, well, shared vision of yada yada marketing speech. It's a normal ultra thin and light laptop, don't really quite understand what is there, the huge vision and reinventing laptop or whatever, because let's be honest, this is just looking like a somewhat, where do I have it even, probably, oh, there, because battery. It looks mostly like a MacBook, so not really quite, not even the most attractive. It looks a little bit like a Huawei, was it MateBook or something, in my opinion. For me, this recessed keyboard stuff, not even the most pretty, but maybe at least the keys don't touch the display like on MacBooks. And essentially creates the best laptop in the world. And it might at least, so I don't really quite agree that it's that different, and also still wonder about repairability, but it might very well be the very best AMD laptop, especially with added graphic cores, GPU cores, and a slimmer form factor. They wrote here somewhere, they literally spent tens of thousands of hours co-developing, co-engineering hand in hand with Microsoft, not just optimizing CPU and GPU. I really wonder, I mean, this is a little bit marketing speech. This is also why I'm really getting frustrated with this kind of YouTube news of other people like, buy this amazing stuff, it's the most amazing. Not a paid advertisement here, though. And concrete examples, right? What have they really done here? So far, I only see added GPU cores and overall system power management, pen, touch, memory bandwidth, firmware drivers deliver. I would think, so first of all, AMD has their firmware memory bandwidth optimized as much as they can in general. Not really seeing their AMD doing a better job just having some Microsoft engineers sitting there. And so far I only see, okay, added GPU cores and maybe optimized power management and firmware. Also on the Intel SKU, I made a video, I mentioned this, there is this Intel, they have on the Surfaces, starting from the Surface Pro 4, they have touch running on the GPU, which I find really crazy. Intel iGPU touch, or some precision touch or something, whatever that was, GPU isolated touch and stylus, that is IPTS, Intel, hello, where is that, probably this one, and probably still not in the kernel, and you need to load special firmware, that is additionally why I couldn't recommend any new Surface anyway due to this. You see, you need to patch your kernel, you need to have their Intel iTouch, and how crazy is this? I called this out in the previous videos, stop integrating all this bullshit altogether. We need boundaries, we need minimal working drivers and not everything mixed together, and in the end your GPU stuff crashes, your touch stuff crashes, nobody can debug this. And in a couple of, well, in every other Windows update, something breaks, and so on. It's hilarious. We, by the way, had some comments there. Good evening. Comments in the audience looks nice. So thanks for joining everyone. So, well, the specs look like, so I'm not the extremely greatest fan of Jaspers, even look wherever it was. Anyway, but you can always argue about design, so USB A, USB, they also, so they finally changed from, what did they even had? Some mini display port and USB 3 or something. So they finally adapted USB-C. Did they probably, they didn't even have Thunderbolt before. Is there Thunderbolt? Anyway, so yeah, that is my question. So it might very well be the best, well, we don't even need Cynos, right? I already called this out for wherever I have the Ethernet dongle, right? Don't even need that Cynos if I can't plug in an Ethernet cable. Certainly this doesn't have Ethernet, so I personally much rather go with perfectly fine working standard models where there is no special Microsoft glue in there and I can plug in Ethernet and have everything working and have a pad and stuff at TrackPoint. So yeah, many parts are amazing, but calling this out, why are we also here on this channel? If you developed something amazing, then really call it out more precisely, otherwise it's just marketing bullshit. Maybe they didn't even sit together. You're doing for optimized firmware. Also, I mean, optimized firmware. The firmware of AMD stuff is already optimized for Windows. It's basically the 99% customer they have anyway. Companies running Windows. So you don't tell me that you need Microsoft engineers sitting there to have better firmware and driver delivered there for. And also very thin and light, again, recurring theme here. Even on Mac, people get tired of thin and light. It might still be the very best AMD, but it might still be too thin for thermals and battery and stuff. Hardware team, silicon allowed to deliver best marketed CPU performance, form factor. And again, nothing concrete, that's just blah, 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 blah. We are the best, blah, blah, the best. Buy it, blah, blah. It's hilarious. And then at least tell what is this. So 15 watts, the other like AMD ThinkPad also have 15 watts or something, usually at least, or scaling up to between 20 and 25 watts. In my opinion, nothing that we have not seen from previous AMD ultra thin stuff. But so again, until Microsoft calls out here precisely what they really have done better there with AMD, it's just marketing for the AMD chips are amazing anyway, except maybe a couple of graphic cores. The company is even claiming it will outperform a similar MacBook Pro by 70%. Ryzen parts have dedicated GPU cores and optimized by. So yeah, this is certainly amazing. Also, but there you see, even in 2019, Microsoft with AMD innovating more than AMD apparently with aging Intel SKUs and similar stuff. At least they have done away with this stupid fabric cover there, as far as I can see, and they have not even put their page up and page down keys. That annoyed me on the Dell XPS 15. They announced one more thing, which is even more Linux incompatible, which is this X thing here, this Surface Pro X ARM-based Snapdragon. And this, of course, in a way, I can't recommend at all. This is why you're certainly here on this channel, the only channel on YouTube which advises you not to buy all this stuff. So probably don't buy. However, one thing is relatively cool. So where is it even? Pro X, and here it is. So with this kickstand and super ultra slim, of course, what you get from ARM Silicon. So that is, I think, Snapdragon it was. Available November 5th for pre-order starting today, beginning at $999. So ARM, of course, it means unlike they, I think the previous surfaces were the ARM Windows RT ones were completely locked as far as I know until someone broke it. And I would not imagine Microsoft makes installing Linux or any other alternative OS easy on this. However, it would be cool. So not only does this really look good if you would have wanted some ARM Linux laptop, only calling Microsoft out here, if you want to be such a good open source citizen and more amazing than Apple, then maybe allow Linux. Fun fact, I could very theoretically order one with trying to EFI boot ARM Linux and return it if it doesn't boot, but usually I don't really condemn such behavior of returning it just for testing it. One thing I wanted to really call out here, which we probably should, so yeah, this looks good and certainly the keyboard you need to buy additionally, overcharging for everything and the pen, so the pen is there in the keyboard, which is certainly somewhat nicely integrated. Here's this pen storage charging there. The biggest thing and the only thing why I actually could recommend this somewhat, and there you see the difference between Apple and Microsoft even. So the previous Surfaces, the biggest showstopper, which I anyway couldn't recommend them, is everything glued together, and you couldn't even swap the storage. Recurring theme here, huge fan of being able to swap an SSD, even if I'm using it heavily for Teak 2 compilation or whatever, and the SSD is defect after 5 years or data recovery or upgrades, then Microsoft has here one really nice trick up the sleeves, which is some recessed door there, like Apple did like 15 years ago on MacBook Pros or iBooks or PowerBooks. Some door latched mechanism there where you not only can swap the SIM card for your LTE, but also a regular standard, at least they say here M.2, so 4042, whatever that is, in 4420 or whatever, maybe the M.2 40, whatever the 40 size is, 4420 or 40, maybe that. R2242 maybe, I guess is it that one, but correct me if I'm wrong. Maybe we click on that and see what we 40, that does not look 2242, or maybe it is. You get the idea, and so that is, there you see Apple, you can do this, and even Microsoft can do this, and this is what I would expect from either this. In my opinion, I made the previous video there, how to have a, I don't even have a tablet with me because I'm a creator, not a consumer, just consuming stuff. I made this video where I proposed if you have this aluminium stuff and then just to have the back panel to remove with 8 screws or something, amazing stuff, previous videos there. And either the whole panel, because then you can also service the battery, so still probably not amazing, not my design, which maybe I should patent and license to them. Just makes a whole back cover removable. You can even have some silicon ring in there or whatever for water protection stuff. But at least better than Apple, in my opinion. That is certainly the biggest thing that I should mention here. Otherwise, yeah, looks quite good. We have also, this marketing renders always look amazing, but I have to agree, it looks pretty neat. Rounded rectangle, similar to iPad, right? But unlike, so I'm, again, nothing announced, certainly they only care about Windows, so Linux bootability, zero clue. In general, most of the stuff not recommendable, because certainly, although probably I would expect the regular Surface AMD thing there, laptop, to probably be able to boot Linux with regular x86 IFI boot stuff, at least all my Surfaces, although they are aging, did. But again, don't just go and buy it, because A, I can't recommend it fully. Second of all, Linux bootability question mark, especially on the ARM version. Although again, I'm slightly tempted for the ARM version, because just to test Linux bootability. But then if I buy it, it doesn't boot, then I don't certainly want to spend 1 year reverse engineering and hacking like on iBoot there on the Apple stuff. So, but this is also a recurring theme here on this channel, what we shout out, make stuff also for any Samsung or Apple stuff. Users should be able to install their shit, whether it be Linux, Haiku, BSD, or how did the audience call it, Renux or something, our upcoming microkernel system or whatever. But if you have any details there, leave me in the comments below. I wonder if you probably don't have a Microsoft store in Berlin to go there and try to unlock the Q-boot. But that's it for the summary. Let's see what we have in the comments, which I need. Yeah, why do I need to pop-up chat this? Because if I zoom the whole window, then the pop-up chat moves out of the scrolling area, modern web stuff. Dietart also likes the 3x2 display, and that is also, my first Surface, the Surface 2, was with a very large bezel that was totally annoying. Surface 2, the only reason I've only brought this because Linux laptop testing, super huge bezels. I hated this from the very first day. So Microsoft Surface 3 did much better, and this is the only reason why I got this. And again, due to the stupid Entric touch disease stuff, I would not even buy a new one. Also ultra thin overheating, and in the meantime, outdated stuff. So the thin bezels here and 3x2 display, certainly pretty cool. But again, with the usual Microsoft mileage may vary. Here's probably, is that image credit Microsoft Surface Pro 7. Hey, that would be before my birthday, amazing stuff. Surface Pro 7, but again, the Surface, yeah, but even the Surface, there you see innovation nowadays, somewhat. Apple has not a custom silicon of Intel Core i9 or something, so Microsoft, Apple has in the iPad and iPhone, but Microsoft even has now in their Surface laptop, which is more. And again, also strange fact, right? I wanted to mention this, that in 2019, all the companies need their own silicon. Previously, we had standard CPUs, and this is also not cool, because we end up with, we have already the problem that each ARM system needs their own dedicated Linux kernel, memory mapped IO stuff, and all the other platform specific GPIO and whatever artificial intelligence acceleration stuff. And this Microsoft Pro X has exactly the same. So they wrote here with Qualcomm, and I wanted to mention this, good that I remember. So they also have developed their GPU stuff with Qualcomm for this X. And so that is, Microsoft has a 7nm SQ1, although I wonder slightly who manufactured this 7nm, which, oh, okay, TSMC is right. So probably TS, or is it Qualcomm? Do they, TSMC? Anyway, and again, the same marketing bullshit, right? Focused on improving both CPU and GPU power over the regular Snapdragon. And yeah, so here you heard it first on this live channel, live on YouTube, Microsoft SQ1. So we have no Apple something, and SQ probably Surface Qualcomm 1 or whatever. And Kuro CPU and octa-core, so that is similar to other ARM laptops that we previously made a video on, ARM laptops versus it. And first and fastest ever Kuro at 3 GHz. And so yeah, just for this fact, if, by the way, so fun fact, there you see Microsoft could even sell some to Linux users. They have sold they've sold two Surfaces to me as Linux developer just for x86 tablet stuff. I would might even be tempted to buy this one if they would officially say, hey, this stuff is booting with ARM EFI, you can boot it yourself. Maybe I would even get one just for the highest performance. However, they also optimized graphic, and they don't clearly write what here. So GPU itself is 2.1 teraflops, which is, again, stupid marketing speech, of course, only for massive parallel single instruction multiple data running there, the same 1024 2048 stream shader stuff there through it. But here is not one single note what kind of GPU this is, right? Only the GPU, the GPU, the GPU, and that's everything we get here. And that is a little bit sad for tech journalism. How did we end up in a time that in 1980 you had clearly this IBM PC has this Intel 8086 or 8088 and this Hercules graphic or whatever, the first IBM PC. And nowadays we have only, it's teraflops. It's like the GPU, it's optimized. And yeah, like seriously, what the heck? Can you not write clearly what a GPU core is? So even if it would boot Linux, then yes, certainly you don't have a GPU driver because of this proprietary stuff. And yeah, unfortunately, they only write here multiple 4K displays over a single USB-C cable. Perhaps we'll eventually see native versions of, yeah, only perhaps speculation, yada yada, blah blah blah. And only significant computation of the GPU. And I think they've stuck, because it's 2019, of course, they've stuck a neural engine in there, some artificial intelligence, machine learning accelerator, whatever they mean by that. And it's also unclear whether they have dedicated silicon or if they mean the GPU, although I think some news made it sound like it's dedicated. But yeah, all in all, tech journalism this is what we are here for, calling this out. Hello, we want real specs. I slightly wonder Qualcomm, so Qualcomm Snapdragon Kirin or whatever that was called. Maybe not that. And just to get an idea what kind of GPU is usually is in there. Qualcomm whatever in Bluetooth, no, probably hardware codec support, hello, that would be the Creo probably, huh? 64-bit, 32, successor of the 32-bit crate, so what GPU would there be? Nothing written to that sort of... Reno, Snapdragon, series of graphic processor units, Adreno, maybe. Anyway, so yeah, it's a little bit unclear, and this is what I really wish they would be more precise. Of course, not yet a product listing. Navarro writes, Apple products more Linux friendly than Microsoft. Not really, I wouldn't say this. We had this T2 chip, so the latest, so not only my old piece of garbage in the corner has already the EFI magic that is hiding the iGPU, so even this, in the meantime, 7 years approaching Retina MacBook Pro, not the most Linux friendly, and the new ones, you could not even access the SSD. Initially I saw due to the security chip, but later people found out due to probably incompatibilities, there are some 8-bit fields in the NVMe protocol or hardware registers being 16-bit and similar stuff there. So probably in mainline, it's maybe not even mainline. I wouldn't call this Linux friendly, plus the new Apple stuff, not only the security chip, but it also has this ARM iBridge thing. So I would totally not call this Linux friendly. Beside, Apple has a track record of hiding some of the hardware for other OSs and applying undervolting or other custom stuff when booting macOS, and even hiding the iGPU for anything else like Windows and Linux, previous videos down below. So Dieter speculates about SOC for next Xbox. Even Apple products more Linux friendly hardware than Microsoft doesn't product. Ah, okay, yeah, sorry, I should read the whole comment. Yeah, then we agree there, but the Surface is mostly work, so well, my Surface works completely. The only annoying thing, I've not tested the Surface Studio. By the way, fun fact, if someone from Microsoft watches and can't wants to convince me that stuff is more amazing, you can send a Microsoft Studio Surface or whatever this desk thing is there, or any other stuff for me to review. Certainly totally motivated and willing to experiment with Linux compatibility. And then the first MVQ that is against NVMe spec, double Q size, that was not to the... and so the later Surfaces, Linux compatibility, not even my greatest concern. The only super annoying thing is this Intel integrated touch stuff processing that I mentioned before, that is certainly completely annoying. And again, this is why you don't want this, right? Even in Linux, it might be possible to hack it together, but then it's not mainline, not when you just install your Ubuntu or T2 or something Linux, and you have don't have your stuff working. Just today, someone commented below the Apple video, he could boot Linux on some T2 equipped MacBook, but couldn't install it. Like, yeah, you don't have the NVMe double Q size patch stuff there. And also tech journalism, right? Only, I mean, I understand they need to bring out the news just like we need to do. No, I probably left this here, which where we probably have been there, and which probably was this one. And yeah, they need to get the news out and they don't get more information, but I wish the people who are close to Microsoft there would simply ask them what exact GPU stuff is in there, because this is of course really unspecific. But at least one shout out is, so we are not just pure haters. For example, I said this is certainly a much upgrade over the previous Fabric keyboard stuff, where if you open it, you need to heat this top cover there and you destroy all the Alcantara, pseudo fake leather, whatever material stuff there. And at least on the Surface X, you can swap the M2 SSD, which is certainly a much better move and syncing and user repairability and stuff over Apple's glued and soldered stuff. I hope you learned something, and yeah, probably don't buy any of those, totally not recommended, unless if you don't have the choice at the company or whatsoever. Maybe this AMD laptop is still better, I would hope or guess, than an Apple machine. The only thing is, of course, this optimized power stuff. This is, again, that it might not work well with Linux then, although I would think it does. Actually, the fun fact is, on many new machines, Microsoft actually took with a stupid connected standby. Previously, laptops had this suspend to memory and suspend to disk mode, whatever, S4 and S3 or whatever. Always forget whatever S2, 3 and so on, but suspend to memory and suspend to disk. And you can thank Microsoft for most or many modern laptops, including the Surface stuff themselves. They do not support suspend to memory, right? That is pretty annoying in my opinion. They only support suspend to disk, and switching everything off connected standby, as far as I've seen, is simply, at least on the Surfaces of a couple of years ago, like my Surfaces, is simply switching off all the peripherals. So this is like mostly not ACPI done suspend, with just suspending everything on the operating system driver side, like switching the display off. And this is why the battery life, if you in Linux, by fun fact, in Linux, I think they changed this in the kernel earlier. When this was new, you didn't even have memory there. You only had, like, they probably added Freezer for the reason. So the new thing is Freezer, which is a software, as far as I've seen, software only, like driver in kernel only suspending of freezing, like user space processes and hardware, and still being relatively alive until some interrupt occurs that is not disabled. And only later, because I guess I've not followed this discussion, but I can speculate, they re-enabled in the Linux kernel, which I personally hate quite a lot, because then you don't see if your device really supports suspend to memory or not. The new kernels since 3, 4, 5 years, or 3 years or so, I think they emulate memory. So even if you see memory, it might be that your device doesn't support this. And it's, I think they simply mapped memory to Freezer just for compatibility with GNOME and KDE and all the other daemons and management stuff. And then you would need to either look in this and proc files to find out if your hardware really supports suspend to memory, or if this memory is emulated as freezing. That means previously suspend to memory, even on ThinkPads or so, or the X1 Carbon video down below there, I had really long suspend to memory times on the X1 Carbon. I think I had suspend to memory with Linux over 3 days, and then the battery was still not empty, which is only when you travel. And of course, normally you would use it, but it was my second laptop and I traveled, and sometimes I had it suspended for 2 or 3 days. That worked just fine. And the Surface, at least my Microsoft Surface 3, the battery runs down with this stupid Freezer crap, connected standby, the battery runs down in just 1 day, which is totally annoying. You can't even freeze it in the office, go home, go back, and the battery is empty. This is on the next day already. This is hilarious. Amazing innovations that you can thank Microsoft for. In my opinion, laptops should always have suspend to memory. There is no excuse, even if you would want to use this connected memory, connected standby, where Outlook or other, like Thunderbird or stuff, could still fetch email. The connected standby meaning is meant to have the OS still running a little bit, and an email application, because it's not really suspended to memory, could wake up and do some background tasks, or Windows could do some update, which then fails and stuff. And however, you could actually probably have done this for the most part with waking up with suspend to memory and waking it up. So if you would want connected standby. Also, okay, the only benefit is your PC could really, really wake up if you get an email. So you could emulate this with suspend to memory and waking up with RTC, like programming the RTC and waking up every 15 minutes, which might actually be more energy efficient. But so connected standby wastes more power, but the Wi-Fi and some application could probably still be running, which in Linux is probably not supported because the freezer freezes all the user space and turns everything off, I guess. So special programming would be required to make use of this Linux, unless if you know something makes use of this Linux. I don't think so, but leave me in the comments below. But the meaning is you could leave Wi-Fi powered on, power everything off except Wi-Fi, and still have some background task like your email daemon, have the Wi-Fi connection established and check for emails and wake up instantly and have your display on and say, hey, you got an email. But yeah, all the fine details that the tech journalism doesn't talk about, because they only care about, hey, there is some, they optimized it together and it's maybe faster now. Anyway, hope you learned a bunch, as usual, a little bit of insight talking of all the connected standby ACPI stuff. And maybe fact check, as we talked already, we could quickly Google what actually is here the S2. Also, what the heck, I wanted Google, not Google for Goo. ACPI suspend memory S, which one would be? So standby is S2, system appears what, system appears off, has no, what the heck. Suspend modes, BIOS guides, difference between, okay, so S3 is probably, so okay, so S1 is probably power standby. Yeah, super old article, nothing better than those. So S2 standby, okay, so then S1, so S1 is working, S0 is working, also similar to Louis Rossmann, maybe need have not checked his power lines, but something power, something SO, I would hope at least Apple would use the same indication there is BIOS ACPI stuff. But so S0 or SO, S0, how is Louis pronouncing that? Anyway, S0 working completely on, then S1 is standby. All processor caches are flushed and the CPU stop executing instructions. Power to the CPU and RAM is maintained. RAM is refreshed devices, so that is regular. So S1 POS is memory, and maybe I can then also with this memory memorize this for the future. S2 standby, system appears off, system has no power, RAM is refreshed, the system is in lower power mode than S1. Is not commonly implemented. Thank you, BIOS vendors. And again, S1 is also not commonly implemented anymore, at least on the surfaces of mine. Maybe even the X1 Carbon in the future, maybe in the reviews, I need to document this more closely. I had the suspicion the X1 Carbon did not implement this. The S1 suspend to memory. So S3 is standby. The difference is here that in S3 more stuff is powered off, so CPU power supply, reduced power state, memory is still powered, so almost okay, which by the way this is still different than Hibernate. So actually I was thinking Hibernate. So you see so many ACPI states, most are not even used. Do we even have here, is this even used? Windows standby is a version, Windows through XP is some version of Linux Sleep in Vista and Mac OS X. And S4 Hibernate is probably, so this is safe sleeve to disk. S4 is probably also what disk stuff in Linux is using mostly, where everything is off, including the memory. Actually slightly wonder what is in the point of S3, CPU has no power, power supplies and response state, main memory is still powered. Lies in open documents, lies in main memory, the user can resume work exactly when it left off the main memory content, when the computer come back from S3, the same put in S3. S3 has an advantage over S4 that the computer faster to resume than to reboot. Seconds if any running application, prior information, yada yada yada. Anyway, You got the idea, you learned something, I hope. And Jamerican writes, it's second gen Ryzen, not yes, no third gen, wait a sec. Yeah, but I said this, I said second gen, I called this out. But yeah, personally, not only do I like total upgradability, so most likely I will not go for this also, which by the way, fun fact, we probably could have switched the scene to this one. And yeah, I personally totally in love with a trick point. I don't even touch the touchpad. For me, they could produce ThinkPads without any touchpad actually. So for me, most likely next year or something, AMD Ryzen 4000 and mobile. Again, we had live streams, recurring viewers might remember that AMD even confused me. The mobile stuff is half a generation, the plus generation behind with the numbering, totally confusing. And yes, so that is the regular, however optimized by Microsoft and AMD. Again, as I said in the beginning, whatever that might mean, it's a little bit unspecific for my taste. But yeah, no worries for joining late. Thanks for watching. We are totally through here with everything. And as usual, audio still works, amazing stuff. Yeah, thanks for watching. Hope you learned something. Again, I said this before, not the most recommended, although maybe right now the best AMD Ryzen laptop, also still Zen Plus, but with more GPU cores, I would expect it mostly work. Maybe also the question is if they worked there with the firmware, whatever, maybe the touch is as integrated as with Intel's integrated touch GPU stuff, so then, yeah, whatever. So in long story short, mostly not recommended. Some stuff interesting, some stuff better than Apple. Custom silicon on the x86 side, unlike Apple, and more serviceable, especially here, even the ARM one with this door latch thing for the M2 SSD. And back to mail in a second. Thanks for reminding me, I got an email. Yeah, hope you enjoyed this, and don't forget to share, like, and subscribe. I hope you like this daily updates here of random stuff, and as soon, don't forget, second channel. I know I overstress my subscribers who want to see AAA pre-edited super content, which will soon come next to you. Lots of fun stuff. Thanks for the speculation in the comments of future Surface Books and Ryzen. And yeah, there is a more live channel, which hopefully the copyright strike eventually goes away. As soon as it goes away, we will really move over there, because I sometimes lose subscribers for too much random stuff. And as a last call out, although we want to stop now, and we really stop now, is my Intel halved here the prices for the Core X, according to this news site. And there you see competition, right? Also, can we, thank you for auto-playing this garbage. So yeah, half prices, is this one, old price, new price, where would be? So this is probably 10, no, that's confusing. Anyway, at least they're right here, I've not personally checked this, but there you see what competition is doing and how much Intel is falling behind, or not making progress. And there you see when all the Intel fanboys always cried, yeah, but Intel, single thread and turbo boost and whatever, everything amazing. And yeah, thankfully we have competition, because this is what competition brings you, more affordable CPUs, and you see how much overcharged that was so far, that they can lower the prices to stay competitive. Yeah, that's it for today, and see you soon for the next fun videos and live streams to come.